Hey, what's going on, everybody? Kevin L. Johnson from Ozark, and you're watching EC Sports.
Yeah, yo, check it. Turn me up a little bit on the mic.
EC Sports, episode John Elway, bro.
Seven? You're not even going to give me Michael Vick?
Yeah. Fucking Danny always.
Give me some swag to it, man. I mean, Elway's cool, but he lost like five Super Bowls. But I'll give him that. He won a few. Anyway.
Yeah.
Speaking of quarterbacks.
We got to do Michael Vick.
Okay. But speaking of quarterbacks, we got to drop a bomb on your guys' head tops right now. Adam Schefter, the boy Shefty, drops a tweet. And it was kind of surprising. It's draft day today. Of course, this is where all the drama happens, right? Draft day is like the most dramatic time for the NFL season, I feel like. Reigning MVP Aaron Rodgers is so disgruntled with the Green Bay Packers organization that he told people in the organization he doesn't want to return to the team. League and team sources tell ESPN Thursday. More on NFL Live from Shefty. This is directly from one of the GOAT's mouths of the sports. You know, you got Woj bombs and you got Shefty missiles.
Period.
This is what it is.
Do you think it was set up to happen on draft day?
Oh my god, yeah. This is his stock. Aaron Rodgers' stock was already high. Now it's 4X-ing for all you stock heads out there and your stock traders out there. It's 4X-ing right now, quadrupling the value of his stock because he can. What team doesn't want Aaron Rodgers? Except if you're the Kansas City Chiefs and even arguably the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Yeah.
I mean, like, I can't think of anything else. Josh Allen, Bills. But regardless, this is huge news coming in the draft night. And especially with a lot of teams that have a lot of uncertainty at the QB position, moving picks, moving players. I honestly see, you know, a team like, Houston Texans making a move. San Francisco 49ers making a move because they trade up to that third spot. Yeah. That whole Mac Jones rumor mill swirling. What do you think? Like, where do you go if you're the Green Bay Packers and you hear this? Like, where do you go? Are you trying to send them tonight? Are you holding out and send them before the preseason? What are you doing here?
I mean, they drafted their quarterback of the future last year,
so Jordan Love.
Yeah, they can care less about a quarterback. So right now, I just feel like they are just trying to get some picks. You know, obviously this came out for a reason. He clearly doesn't want to be there. It's everywhere. So he's going to be gone. They're not going to trade within a division. Obviously, no. As a Bears fan,
I love
that. But they're not going to, I mean, even if the Bears just gave up everything in life, they would not give him.
They can give him Khalil Mack, half a Soldier Field, 12 picks, every boat on Lake Michigan, whatever you want to call it. You're not getting Aaron Rodgers. The Bears, no. And even for my Raiders, as much as I want Aaron Rodgers to come there and it'd be a dream come true for me, it's not going to happen. I just don't think that's happening.
What's a logical place that he's going to go? I mean,
the only thing I would think is San Francisco because he's from the Bay. They have the number three pick.
Three? Okay.
Yeah, the number three because they traded up. Remember, they traded up to get that third spot. Miami moves down a few slots. Mm-hmm. There's a teams like Denver who can give up a haul for him. Team like, hello, are we forgetting about Bill Belichick's schemes over here?
Yeah.
I mean, if the Patriots get him, like, I am going to just, I don't know. It's ridiculous. You can't even fathom the words coming out of my mouth because the Patriots somehow make a move and get Aaron Rodgers nuts.
I think it's going to be a team that obviously, I don't think he's going to go somewhere to lose.
No, of course not.
It's going
to, the pieces have to be in play, right? Yeah,
absolutely. And I feel that, you know, there's a lot of teams in the league. I mean, obviously they're not coming off the top of my head, but some have young quarterbacks. Others are like, you know, who knows, like New Orleans or like you said, the Patriots. They have systems in place, not really weapons outside of maybe Michael Thomas.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm interested to see what happens.
I think we all are. I mean, this is huge news. I
this
mean,
is something.
This is the MVP we're talking about.
The reigning. You didn't say former. You
yeah,
didn't say
this is the reigning MVP, a couple plays away from potentially making the Super Bowl if everything went right with Matt LaFleur. I knew there was some – you know, I knew there was tension.
What did you think?
Matt LaFleur and Aaron Rodgers, man. Was it? I don't think – I just think, like, Matt LaFleur is a young guy, and I think Aaron Rodgers is, like, I need – like, he needs a Belichick-style coach. He needs someone who's been there before, one, to really have his respect. Aaron Rodgers is a guy – you can go to the trenches with Aaron Rodgers, but don't expect him to be on the front line. You say that with Tom Brady because he will be on the front line diving for everything, and he believes in everybody. Aaron Rodgers believes in himself.
Yeah.
But is he believing around anybody else? I won, y'all lost. That's my mentality, Aaron Rodgers. I mean, he's a great teammate to some. I mean, he's got a great relationship with Devontae Adams because he's one of the best receivers in the NFL. He made him into one of the best receivers in the NFL. But yeah. I don't see him – the relationship, the disconnect between ownership, Matt LaFleur, Aaron Rodgers, there was clearly something there.
Yeah.
And it starts with Matt LaFleur's decision-making, play calling, lack of aggressiveness sometimes, is, you know, not letting Aaron cook. That's the problem with Russell Wilson in Seattle, right? Let Russ cook. They don't let – Matt LaFleur in that playoff game wasn't letting Aaron cook or make his own decisions. I want to go for it on fourth down. I'm not trying to kick a field goal. Yeah. That should have been Aaron Rodgers saying, no, wait, let me get my team together and get it going. But, you know, it happens. But speaking of draft night, I mean, we had to move on to the draft. That was a huge Schefter bomb, by the way. My God. Draft night's here. It was huge, right? I cannot wait. I mean, draft night to you, what is it? What do you think of draft night, first off?
I mean, they switched it around. It's the first round. I mean, it's NFL football. You get to see the guys that you watch in college get drafted, all of the stories and, you know, the information and the Mel Kuypers and the – it's a fun night for football lovers. And, you know, the excitement is building now. You throw in Aaron Rodgers now, you're going to get a lot of that talk. You're going to get some who's going to trade up, or, you know, you look forward to Goodell saying we have a trade. So it's exciting. It's excitement, especially in – we're always excited in Chicago. And then once our pick comes in, their pick is in. First of all, their pick's always in immediately, which means they are just sitting there waiting. Oh, we're going to wait. Oh, you want our card? Here you go. We're ready. Yeah. Been ready for like 4 months.
The sixth tight end they're going to draft or whatever.
Cole Kmet. What? What? Excuse me? So it's that and, you know, the overall excitement as a football fan. What about
you? Of course. I mean, for me, I mean, my team hasn't won anything. So every year is always a possibility. This is going to be the guy who turns it around. And we had a few drafts that were good and successful. 2014 got Carr and Mac, and 2018, 2019 draft. We got Jacobs and, you know, John Abram and all that, and Clint Farrell. So they've had solid drafts with some solid finds. It's just now putting all the pieces together. I'm most excited for the teams that have the most drama. I'm all about the drama. I mean, we all know, you know, Jacksonville is going to go with, Trevor Lawrence. And then it's like, it's a mystery from there. It's like, is Zach Wilson really a number two pick? Is Mac Jones a number three pick to San Francisco? Like, I to this day, I'm still thinking, like, Mac Jones, solid quarterback, but when you're surrounded by every five-star recruit in the damn country, your life's a whole lot easier than it is for a guy like Trey Lance. I'll tell you that.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I'm just waiting for the drama. But who do you think is going to make that big splash surprise? Is it the Niners? Who do you think? Like, who's going to make that splash?
I'm looking forward to see what the Patriots do. They obviously, I've always been a Cam Newton fan, but they obviously have Bill Belichick. So I'm interested to hear and see what happens with Justin Fields, because like we discussed last episode, there's so many different pundits. So he's going to fall. He might fall. Somebody said today he might fall all the way to the Bears. Come on, bro. Really?
Would that be Christmas for then you if that happens? Three.
Yeah. But then he'll go three. And people
to the Niners.
You guys were thinking. Your Texas A&M guy was brought up here. It's being talked about a lot for the last 2 days. So I guess everybody is on the cusp of wondering if they are really seriously going to go into a year where they did not get an extension with Andy Dalton. If that's what they plan on doing, then we should have a new front office.
Yeah, I mean, I think the biggest thing after the first pick, I mean, that's the most exciting. I mean, Trevor Lawrence is a surefire first. It's like, who else can make that move? Like the Jets, for example, they already made the move by getting rid of Sam Darnold. They're looking for a quarterback. That's obvious.
I think that was a little premature.
New man or new coaching staff. I don't know what Sala wants, but me, I'm a big Darnold fan. And I'm not trying to be biased because I like USC, but you know, his talent. What's up?
Teddy Bridgewater.
Oh yeah. So Teddy's gone. No, he goes to Denver.
Trades were because of Sam Darnold.
Yeah. I mean, I think you got to look at Sam Darnold's only 23, man. If he were to got drafted last year, he'd be coming out as a senior at USC. He got out as a redshirt sophomore. So he went extra early. He only had like one season under his belt. Yeah. You know, he's got a ton of talent. He's young. So like the Jets, whatever, they want to go that move. It's the San Franciscos of the world and the Dolphins of the world that are
going to be going back slashers. To Bill.
Bella?
Check. Yeah, is your Jimmy? Cousin Jimmy Garoppolo.
If Jimmy goes back to Bill, I wouldn't be shocked. I've heard the thing with the Patriots is like it's a crapshoot. Yeah. They thought about, you know, they're gonna get a quarterback. 1 week they're gonna get a rookie quarterback, not named Mac or whatever. It was like Justin Fields, Mac Jones. They were looking at Garoppolo. They're looking at trading Stephon Gilmore for more capital. They're looking to move down in the draft as they usually do. So there's a lot of question marks. You never know what you're going to get with Bill Belichick. He never reveals his hand. Clearly a team like the Jets already revealed their hand because they got rid of their asset in Sam Darnold and they're going to go with the QB. But the Patriots are interesting. But like I said, the Niners, probably the most interesting team in this draft right now because they have a ton of options to look at right now at the third.
Yeah, I mean, let's be real.
They really do because look at it. They have a good team. Exactly. They made the right moves to move up. So they have a solid defense. Nick Bosa is coming back. They made a lot of good moves. I mean, they might lose Richard Sherman in the offseason, but they still have great defensive backs. They have a good defense. They're solid all the way around. Their offense.
Mostert.
They beat the Rams twice.
Yeah.
With what Nick Mullins as quarterback, their third stringer. Oh. So imagine if you get a competent quarterback, and no disrespect to Nick Mullins, but he's not an everyday starter. You get a guy like, you know, maybe they make that final move for Deshaun Watson after all these cases. Maybe they go after Justin Fields and start fresh blood. Maybe they go all in for Aaron Rodgers. So that's why they're the most
interesting. Really believe Deshaun Watson will have a job this year?
That's what I'm saying. Who's going to willing to take that risk? San Francisco might.
No.
But – The other case is the Dolphins. They had the third pick traded down. Now they have two picks in the first. Are they going to get Kyle Pitts to solidify the offense? It's just a lot of question marks with the Dolphins too, because everyone's saying they might get rid of Tua to bring in someone.
Oh,
those two teams I'm to keep my eyes on. The one team. What
do you think of Tua the first year?
What's that?
What do you think of Tua the first year?
Tua is a gamer. That's the biggest thing. I always look at him as a competitor. Like he doesn't have the strongest arm in the book. You know what I mean? He's very accurate. When he sets his feet, he's very solid, but he's always like scrambling, making moves. He's got to slow it down a little bit, but he's made big time throws, made big time plays against teams like Arizona, where they got the win there. And they were half a game out or one game out from making the playoffs.
Yeah.
So this team's got a top ranked defense. Brian Flores has his defense working. You know, were king. And they had Xavier, what's his name? The guy who made the one-hand interception to the corner.
What pick do they have?
They have the fifth pick right now.
So with them, do you go?
Sixth. I'm sorry, sixth. Sixth
Pitt pick. Might go to Atlanta from here.
Pitts?
Yeah. Do you think Miami goes for a tackle or?
They would have to. If they're going to stick with two, they got to protect Tua. I think, you know, if Pitts is off the table. Because. Right. Yeah, they could get Penei Sewell and move him or shift around their line. I mean, they have the talent to do it. But if Pitts is gone, who I arguably think is the most talented player in this draft besides Trevor Lawrence at a quarterback position, non-QB, Kyle Pitts is like a mixture of, you know, they say Darren Waller and Kelsey. And it's like, what the hell? How do you get that out of a rookie? He's an instant impact contributor. He's projected 850 to 1,000 yards in his rookie year, wherever he goes. So, you know, if Atlanta gets him, they solidify that offense. It'll be scary, but, you know, it's Atlanta. That's another team that Kyle Shanahan might be targeting with Matt Ryan. And then you have Cincinnati and then falling to Dolphins. Yeah, they'd go tackle.
Yeah, Cincinnati definitely should go tackle.
Yeah, but
do you think they need to get some offensive weapons?
That's another thing. Their wide receiving core, yeah. You don't want to try to – do you go all in for Ja'Marr Chase right away? Could you trade down and get him? Because Ja'Marr Chase is like the prize possession at wide receiver if you can't get Kyle Pitts. LSU, right? Yeah, LSU. He sat out for a year, I believe.
Yeah.
But he's talented. I would go Devontae Smith. That's just me. I'm more of a guy who's proven he won the Heisman. But
people don't like – I mean, you look at the where he went. Obviously, he's playing competition. He won the Heisman. He did what he was supposed to do. So,
and at the highest level possible in the college game.
At the epitome of college.
Didn't he tear it up in the championship game? In the championship game, didn't he tear up Clemson too?
Yeah, a lot.
Like, I just don't understand. It's like, okay.
This guy's played Clemson like they weren't even like suitable.
It was a spring game for him. It was a spring game. Oh, I'm just going to run this quick post.
Now, oh, he's all of a sudden too skinny and this and that. NFL teams know how to put weight. They know how to do all of that shit, bro.
Yeah. So, I mean, look at Marvin Harrison. Yeah. Marvin Harrison was built like a hanger. Like, mm-hmm. He's just so wiry, and then they put on some weight on him, but he was the most shifty guy on the field.
Totally. And then they have a ready-made quarterback. Burrow showed in his rookie season that, you know, he's going to do it. Who's their coach?
Are you talking about who?
Cincinnati.
Was it Zach Taylor? Is Zach Taylor still the coach?
Yeah. Okay. So,
I mean, before he blew out his knee, since he had some promise to them when it comes to Joe Burrow.
So, I mean, I'm looking forward to see what they do. But yeah, overall, the draft is a draft, bro. You sit there and you watch and you listen and, you know, you understand and then, you know, you see what. You want to do, you know, I have Dylan watching it with me like, bro, you got to watch this. You can see like all of the intricacies of what they're saying about quarterback. Look at how Justin has been up and down and up and down. Someone he's watched like since high school. So,
oh, definitely.
It's like a good, you know, learning experience and as well as entertaining. But I think the Aaron Rodgers is going to take over a lot tonight.
I'll tell you this. And for my team, the Las Vegas Raiders, if they're not drafting a corner or a linebacker, you will see me playing in traffic on a major highway by myself. I will jump on a freeway. They got 17. If they don't get a guy like JC Horn, who's a corner, if Patrick Surtain, God willing, falls to that and we don't make a move to try to get him, I'm going to lose it. I'm literally going to, if we don't get a linebacker from Penn State or Notre Dame, I'm going to lose it.
Yeah.
I kid you not. I don't want to see us drafting Jalen Waddle. I don't want another Alabama receiver. I want defense. We don't need
that. Like,
we don't.
No, you have to go on the other side of the ball.
You have to. I don't know. I kid you not. If they get anything outside a corner or a linebacker, you will see me on the news on 580. And I will be running and playing in traffic causing a scene. I am not playing games anymore. Oh, God. Anyway, speaking of draft, though, last episode, Dion and I were talking, like, you know, there's been a lot of players who have promise, but they just don't pan out, especially in the last 10 years because of how, you know, one and done freshmen, this whole thing, people drafting up high, trading up. So we came up with a list, and it's going to be the top five most disappointing players drafted on a team in the last 10 years. So, Dion, go ahead and do the honors and give us your team first. This is draft night, so we're talking. We went from NFL to NBA, but it's still draft talk. Go ahead.
I took away, just to be nice, 20 and 21 because you got to give guys a chance to be bums. So, I'm going to go top five and then I'm going in order. Number five is 2011 pick, number six by the Wizards, Jan Vesely. Who are you? Jeez. Danny might know because I
do. God. This and the sad part is that 11 draft had guys like Klay Thompson, Vucevic, Kawhi Leonard, Tobias Harris,
all after
Kemba Walker.
Guys, we're going top 10. So anybody after that he just named was after 10. Those guys are super. He just named superstars right now. He said Kawhi Leonard. That's all I got to say.
Yeah, Kawhi Leonard, Klay Thompson, both NBA champions. Vucevic, all-star. Tobias Harris, potential all-star. Jimmy Butler at 30. He was a steal. He was a steal, though. Kemba Walker at 9, all-star. So there was a lot of players you could have gotten.
It's at 30, but you got Jan Vesely at 6. All right, number 4, Kevin Knox. He's very disappointing, bro. His rookie season, he came out guns a-blazing. And he was the number 9 pick by the Knicks in 18. He's kind of falling off. Tibbs isn't that. He's not doing something, because if Tibbs isn't playing you, because Tibbs likes to give hours to dudes, he's probably not playing no D.
No, Knox just didn't get better. That's the only sad part. He had potential. He has talent. I mean, you showed it in the preseason when he was a rookie. You showed it in a few bright spot games. But just, I didn't see any improvement.
Yeah. Number 3. Everybody knows me, knows I hate this dude. Wendell Carter Jr., you are a bum. You're in Orlando now, where you belong on a rebuilding bum team for a bum to run. You're a bum. You can't even get carjacked correctly. You're terrible. I hate you, and I'm glad you're gone. You bum.
I just love how blunt you are with this. The one thing I'll give you, Wendell Carter, is, you know, actually, I don't know what to give him. That's the thing. But here's a scouting report. Brings his lunch pail to work. He's a hard crashing the rebounding glass. The Bulls love this kind of guy. Hard working on both ends. But he's not doing anything.
No, he's not.
All right, next.
Number 2, Dragan Bender. Phoenix, 2016. Number 4. That means, could you give me some people that were drafted after number 10?
I believe in that year, 2016, I'm thinking, they could have went. They had 2 bad picks that year. They picked 4 at Dragan Bender, and they picked 8 with Marquese Chriss.
Oh my God.
I mean, they could have had guys like, I believe Bogdan Bogdanovich, who is there. They could have got somebody if they were going to go international.
Happened to be there.
Who was it?
Jamal Murray was in there.
Yeah, Jamal Murray was there. Jamal Murray was at 7.
Yeah, he's pretty good.
Oh my God, he's pretty good. Yeah, he's pretty freaking good. He's decent. Yeah, he's a nice player.
Chris Dunn was in that draft. That bum.
He was like the 3rd pick, wasn't he?
Yeah. Sabonis was 11.
Yeah.
This was a bad draft.
Yeah, Georgios Papagiannis. Oof.
Harris LeVert was 20.
That was a steal pick, though. Anything beyond 18 is like
the biggest you steal find of the draft was Pascal Siakam at 27.
Jeez.
Yeah, DeJounte Murray was in there at 20.
And what number was this? Number 2?
This was number 2.
So you're at number 1 now.
So my number 1 overall, let me get back here. My number 1 overall, I don't even – Jacob, he's still in the league according to you. Jacob
Poeltl.
What's he doing right now?
I mean, he plays on the Spurs.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's always I don't know.
Yeah. Let's go with yours.
Number 5, I'm going to go Frank Kaminsky. I don't know what Michael Jordan was thinking. He was enamored by Frank Kaminsky and what he can bring to the table. Fine, do it. But when a team wants to trade 2 first-round picks to get that spot so you can get Frank Kaminsky at the further spot, what were you risking, MJ? I don't understand. He's not really doing much. I don't even know what team he's on now. Oh, he's on the Suns. Chris Paul's making him hit threes, and you know he's listening to Chris. Chris Paul's making him get his dry cleaning for him. But okay, let's go to the next guy. Picked after Anthony Davis. Okay, you're thinking who could it be? Could it be Damian Lillard? No, it's Michael Kidd-Gilchrist. How can a guy who has a jump shot like this, okay, that comes all the way around, worse than Lonzo Ball, who can kind of defend but wasn't a great defender, who can kind of make a play but is not really a 5-tool guy, go number 2. The fact that he played alongside Anthony Davis helps. He is – I don't even think he's in the league right now, Michael Kidd-Gilchrist. And if he is, he's probably a 14th man somewhere. I don't know where he is.
You don't think he's in the league?
I don't think he's in the league.
Wow. Hold on 1 second. I'm going to edit this. Sorry about that.
It's okay. Where was I at? Okay, so yeah, Michael Kidd-Gilchrist.
What's up, Danny?
Hey, what's up? How are you?
Good. How about you?
Good, man. Good. Keep killing it. So Michael Kidd-Gilchrist.
I mean, like, how is he in a league?
I just don't. One team, he's just not in the league.
On his jumper.
Okay, I don't know. But number three, I'm gonna go Wesley Johnson, picked by the Timberwolves. He played 1 year in college and was a sixth man of the year and didn't do anything after that. That's all I got to say.
By the way,
he was picked before, he was one pick before DeMarcus Cousins.
Ugh.
Think about that. Number Nick
Gilchrist is not in the league, by the way.
Oh, he's not.
No.
Oh God. Number two, we're going to go with Thomas Robinson. Do you remember Thomas Robinson?
Yeah.
Picked by the Sacramento Kings.
Then he played for Portland.
Yes. He traveled a lot of ways. He's international now. He's playing overseas. Thomas Robinson was built like Dwight Howard, but was not Dwight Howard. He just was not Dwight Howard. Undersized center who got picked. Very strong guy, but he just didn't fit in a league where if he would have came out now, he could be a solid wing defender four. But he just came, his time was way too early. I feel like, you know what I mean? The way he plays doesn't fit the style back in 2012, but it would fit the style of now. But unfortunately, he's out of the league. Number one, you got to go Anthony Bennett, man.
Oh.
We're talking bums. Number one pick by the Cleveland Cavaliers. Look, I feel like the Cleveland Cavaliers, every 3 years, get a number one pick.
Yeah. But
and look what they do with it most of the time.
I mean, you can't really knock them. They got Kyrie and LeBron.
They did get Kyrie and LeBron, but then they also drafted Anthony Bennett and Andrew Wiggins.
Andrew Wiggins is still in the league.
Yeah, which he's a good player, but he's not a superstar like you're supposed to be.
When you get LeBron and Kyrie, bro, it's like
– true.
I can't knock them, but Anthony Bennett definitely is a bum.
Yep.
His middle name is Bum.
There's so many more we could talk about. I mean, Dante Exum on the Jazz, unfulfilling point guard. Doug McDermott. I can't believe the Bulls. Man, don't get me started on that. They traded Gary Harris and Blazers.
Oh,
Nurkic, Yusuf Nurkic. They got rid of Nurkic and Gary Harris to get this guy.
What?
Yeah.
I don't even want to look that up.
Nurkic and Gary Harris, man. For a non-rotation player. There's so many, man. Jahlil Okafor, Chicago's own.
Oh.
Loved them in college.
What was the dude's name? The center from, you said Thabeet. Oh,
Hashim Thabeet from UConn. Oh. He was terrible.
UConn, right?
Yeah, really bad. I think there was Frank Ntilikina from the Knicks. He was number eight pick. And here's the thing. Tibbs is actually giving him minutes to be a defender. Yeah. But he's not a number eight pick.
No.
You know what I mean? So Josh Jackson, that's another guy. Oh, my God.
Justin, what's his name? From Miami.
Always going to be Sacramento. I'm sorry to the city of Sacramento. Marvin Bagley over Luka Doncic. I'm never going to forget that. Even DeAndre Ayton over Luka Doncic, but at least Ayton, you know, he's a 7-foot center. Like, blah, blah, blah. You know, you got to go with the big
Phoenix
man.
Phoenix is good.
Phoenix is good.
I want to see Phoenix in the West. Chris Paul, bro. Come on. He almost went to the finals with
Houston. Almost don't count, bro.
All right. We'll see.
When you miss 20 – I'll tell you this, Deion. When you miss 27 straight threes and all of a sudden you complain about your hamstring, I don't know. Chris Paul, to me, great regular season player. If I needed – this is a hot take maybe for next episode. If I needed one big game to win, give me Rajon Rondo over Chris Paul. That's all I got to say.
Okay, I'm going to end the show on that. That is disrespectful. But for Danny, we'll talk about that next week for sure. This is Deion, EC Sports.